If you have your Bibles this morning, Matthew chapter 5, you saw a brief introduction on the video to the Sermon on the Mount. I've lost my voice almost completely, so hopefully you can hear me this morning. Andy might have to keep turning me up as we go throughout the service. Matthew chapter 5. In about 400 A.D., Augustine, potato, potato, however you want to pronounce his name, Augustine coined the phrase the Sermon on the Mount. And we've had that phrase ever since for Matthew chapter 5, 6, and 7. I'm going to preach off of each beatitude over the next 8 Sundays, and then I'm going to preach larger segments of this passage of Scripture, and we're going to work our way for several months, verse by verse, through Matthew 5, 6, and 7, which I believe is some of the greatest parts of Scripture because it's the greatest sermon ever preached by the greatest preacher to ever walk the face of the earth, Jesus Christ himself. Some people argue whether it's his exact sermon or whether it's just a summary of his sermon. I'm not going to get into a lot of detail on some of this because that's 4 or 5 sermons in himself. Luke chapter 6 is what's called the Sermon on the Plain. Many people argue whether the Sermon on the Plain in Luke chapter 6 is the same as the Sermon on the Mount. People that have gone before me that are much smarter than I am, like Origen and Chrysostom, believe it's the same. But Augustine believes it's not. One of my favorite old-time preachers, theologians of all times, John Broadus. John Broadus says for 3 reasons he believes the Sermon on the Mount, Matthew 5, 6, and 7, and the Sermon on the Plain, Luke chapter 6, are the same for these 3 reasons. Number 1, they both start out exactly the same. They both talk about Jesus sitting down and the disciples coming to them, and he begins to teach them. Now, it says in Matthew 5 that he went up on a mountainside. In Luke chapter 6, it says he went on a level place, and the argument is he found a level place on the mountainside to speak. The second reason John Broadus gives for his belief on why he thinks the Sermon on the Mount and the Sermon on the Plain are the same are that almost all the contents of the Sermon on the Plain in Luke chapter 6 are found in the Sermon on the Mount, Matthew 5, 6, and 7. And then both the Sermon on the Mount and the Sermon on the Plain are immediately followed in their gospel accounts by Jesus' entrance into Capernaum and the healing of the centurion servant. And so I'm going to kind of side with John Broadus. I believe they're one and the same. Some is included in one that's not included in the other, but I believe they're 2 accounts of the same sermon that Jesus preached. Let me read our text for you. I'm going to read the first 12 verses. We're going to go back to Matthew chapter 5, verse 3, and focus on that verse, what it means to be poor in spirit this morning. But Matthew 5, verse 1, out of the English Standard Version, says, "Seeing the crowds, he went up on a mountainside, and when he sat down, his disciples came to him." Verse 2, "And he opened his mouth, and he taught them, saying, 'Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they'll be comforted,'" or blessed, some people say. "Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be satisfied." They shall be comforted. "Blessed are the merciful, for they will receive mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they'll be called sons of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when others revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account." Jesus says, "Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven, for so they persecuted the prophets who were before you." Now, as we get into the Sermon on the Mount, we'll look at what it means to be salt and light. We'll look at 6 different sayings where Jesus says, "You've been told this by the religious leaders, but I tell you, I'm the greatest prophet of all time. I'm the writer and inspiration of the Scriptures. You've been told wrong. Let me explain the truth to you." Then in Matthew chapter 6, he's going to talk about 3 things we should do because we love Jesus. We should pray, we should fast, and we should give to the poor, the needy. Then he's going to talk about what it means to store up treasures on earth or treasures in heaven. Then he's going to talk about the 2 different paths, one that leads to hell and one that leads to heaven. He's going to give us what I believe is the greatest message of all again. Some people have called the Sermon on the Mount the Constitution of Christianity. And if that be true, the Beatitudes are the preamble to the Constitution. So I think it's very important that we walk through each of these in a sermon by themselves. Now, the big debate is the Sermon on the Mount something we're supposed to live out today? I know it sounds odd when I say that, but there's a lot of people who think it's impossible to live out the Sermon on the Mount, and it's something that's going to happen in heaven one day. I disagree. Listen to people that know much more than I do, and then I'll tell you my belief as well on this. John Stott said, "This sermon is the best known part of the teaching of Jesus, but arguably the least understood, and certainly the least obeyed." Dr. Martin Lloyd-Jones said, "If you regard any particular injunction in this sermon as impossible, your interpretation and understanding of it must be wrong." Why? Because the theme for the Sermon on the Mount is never mentioned in the Sermon on the Mount. You should be listening when I say that. The Holy Spirit is the theme of the Sermon on the Mount. It's never mentioned in the Sermon on the Mount, but we cannot live a righteous life before God without the power of the Holy Spirit working in and through our life. And so Sermon on the Mount is something that we should be living today, not by our own strength, but by the power of Almighty God who lives in and through our life. So if you're here this morning, and as we walk through the Sermon on the Mount verse by verse, this has never described your life. You've never been poor in spirit. You've never mourned over your sins after you've been saved. Then you maybe have never been saved. If you don't hunger and thirst for righteousness, then you've never been satisfied by God. If you're not merciful, then you've never met the King of mercy, Jesus Christ. And so I know it's impossible for us to live out the Sermon on the Mount in our own strength, but we should be striving as we're being sanctified to be more and more of what God's called us to be. And it's not our strength that lives it out anyway. It's the power of Almighty God living in us. So don't forget that as we walk through the Sermon on the Mount. Our theme verse this morning, verse 3. "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven." So we're going to look at that verse. We're going to break it into three parts. What does it mean to be blessed, blessed, what it means to be poor in spirit, and what the result is, theirs is the kingdom of heaven. In a very simple sermon, but before we get into that, let's don't overlook verses 1 and 2 of Matthew chapter 5. Verse 1 again. "Seeing the crowds, he went up on the mountain, and when he had sat down, his disciples came to him, and he opened his mouth and he taught them, saying." So guess who the sermon is for? The disciples. Mathetes in the Greek. We're his disciples. This sermon is just as much for us as it was for the first disciples of Jesus Christ. But don't think it was for just the disciples, because the crowds are following him. Later on in Matthew, it tells us that the people followed him for several days. Some people think this sermon might have taken 3 days, and we just see a synopsis of it because of what happens in later on in Matthew. But the disciples are there, but the crowds are following Jesus for all the miracles Jesus had done. So there could be thousands of people here. We know the religious leaders are there, and Jesus is going to slam them later on in the sermon. But the message is mainly for his disciples to know what it means to be a true disciple of Jesus Christ, to be filled with the power of the Holy Spirit, to allow God to work in and through our life. I think it's interesting that it says that he sat down and his disciples came to him. And the way it's phrased in the Greek, it says, "and Jesus opened his mouth." I mean, you can't speak without opening your mouth, right? But it tells us in the Greek language that Jesus opened his mouth. That's why I like the ESV translation here. Why? Because it's Jesus and it's telling us and reminding us, "Thus saith the Lord." God himself is opening his mouth and he's telling us what it means to be his disciples and be Holy Spirit filled and Holy Spirit empowered every single day of our life. But it's interesting that Jesus sat down. If you know anything about the culture in the New Testament times, any prophet that was speaking on behalf of his authority would sit down and everybody else would stand. So Jesus, being the King of authority, he sat down, his disciples came, and they stood, and he preached to them from a seated position. I'm not going to sit down for you this morning, and I'm not going to ask you to stand during the whole sermon time, or most of y'all would probably leave this morning because your pastor's too long-winded as it is. But it's funny how we follow tradition sometimes and forget what the scriptures say. So if you get upset with some of the contemporary preachers who sit on a stool and preach and want to argue about it, they're probably a little more biblical than some of us that stand. That's just tradition, though. I like standing. I fall asleep if I sit down like some of you do each Sunday when you sit down. So, well, We'll focus on verse 3 in a minute. Let's go to verse 20. If you have your Bible open, it's not on the screen, but I will use this verse every Sunday as we go through the Sermon on the Mount because I believe it's the theme verse of the Sermon on the Mount. Again, the Sermon on the Mount is all about being empowered by the Holy Spirit, living out of a life of grace from Jesus Christ, being sanctified, being set apart. We've never arrived there, but we're striving to be more and more every day of what God's called us to be. I pray that I'm much more sanctified and set apart for God tomorrow than I am today, and much more than I was last week. That's why when you sing songs like God Knows Our Thoughts, it should break us because we know we've all sinned and fallen short of God this week. We'll talk about what it means to mourn over our sins next Sunday as we celebrate Memorial Day and those who have fallen. We'll talk about what it really means to mourn, not just for our country and the fallen ones, but even more so for our own sin, not just the sins of the world. But verse 20 of Matthew 5, the theme verse says this, "For I tell you," Jesus says that a lot, "I'm telling you, pay attention, I'm telling you," this is Jesus, "unless your righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and the Pharisees, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven." You got thousands of people there. The disciples are there. The Pharisees, the Sadducees, the Sanhedrin, some of them are probably there. How would you feel if you're a religious leader and Jesus says, "Unless your righteousness surpasses some of these religious leaders sitting here, you will not be saved and go to heaven"? How do you think the disciples felt when they heard that? Because what they're hearing is it's impossible for us to be saved because these are the most righteous people we know. How can we be more righteous than them? And Jesus is teaching that they had their own self-righteousness, but they didn't have the righteousness of Christ living in them and flowing through them. They bragged about what they did for God on the outside, but they didn't know Jesus Christ in their hearts. That means if we truly want to be saved, it's not about our religious showing on a Sunday or a Wednesday. It's about being saved by Almighty God, and Christ has placed His Holy Spirit inside of us, and His righteousness, not our own, His righteousness lives in and through our life. When you realize it's not your righteousness, you will be poor in spirit. When you realize it's not your righteousness, you will be broken over your sin. You'll be meek. You'll hunger and thirst for righteousness. You'll be merciful. You'll be pure in heart. So let's break this down this morning. Verse 3 again, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven." Here's the first point I want you to see this morning from verse 3. I am blessed because God saved me. Nobody said amen. Wake up this morning. You should be blessed that God has saved you this morning. That's the greatest blessing of all. Now, when you read this, a lot of commentators, I've read 9 commentators this week on the Sermon on the Mount. Most of them want to translate blessed as happy. So they read the text as happy are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. I don't believe that's the best interpretation, and so do a lot of Greek scholars, again, that I'm not a Greek scholar, but many of them think that happy is not the best, or fortunate is not the best understanding of that word blessed. Because we are happy based on our circumstances. And it says in verses 10, 11, and 12 that we should be rejoicing and glad when we're persecuted for living for Christ. Those aren't the greatest circumstances. That's not what we call happy. We have the joy of the Lord as our strength, so that's despite our circumstances. But the best literal reading of the Greek, and hang with me because when I say this, you're going to disagree until I explain it to you, but the literal rendering from the Greek for that word makarios for blessed is approved by God. Now think about it. Approved by God are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Approved by God are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Approved by God are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Approved by God are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they'll be satisfied, they'll be comforted. Approved by God are the merciful, for they'll receive mercy. Approved by God are the pure in heart, for they'll see God. Approved by God are the peacemakers, so they'll be called sons of God. Approved by God are those who are persecuted because of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. What does it mean to be approved by God? How do you earn the approval of God? Because as soon as I say the word approved, you're thinking of some works-based thing that you have to do. And that's wrong. When God saves us, we have His approval because now we're His children. We're the sons and daughters of the Most High King. So when you were saved, you had the stamp of approval of Almighty God on your life, and now you are approved by God. Not based on what you have done or I have done, but what Jesus Christ did on the cross at Calvary. We are approved by Him. So you could read it this way. Saved are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Saved are those who mourn, for they'll be comforted. Saved are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Saved are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they'll be filled. Saved are the merciful, for they'll receive mercy. Saved are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Saved are the peacemakers, they'll be called sons of God. Saved are those who are persecuted because of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Once you were saved, the Holy Spirit infused you, empowered you, and the Holy Spirit causes us to be poor in spirit. We have God's approval because we're going to be in glory with Him forever. So don't leave here this morning thinking we can work these up in our life, that if we just try harder, we can be more poor in spirit. I can make myself just really weep more when I sin, even though I really don't want to in my heart. It's not going to happen by trying harder. It's going to happen because we love Jesus more than anything in this world, and we realize what Jesus Christ has done on the cross for us. We realize we don't deserve to be saved. We will be poor in spirit. We'll be mournful over our sins. Look at the results of each one of the Beatitudes, because all the results are describing ultimately heaven one day. Don't miss this. Go back to verse 3. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. It's now, and it's one day. It's in the present tense. We'll talk about that at the close of this sermon. Verse 4, blessed are those who mourn, for they'll be comforted or satisfied. Guess where the greatest comfort and satisfaction is going to come one day? In heaven forever. Blessed are the meek, verse 5, for they shall inherit the earth. God's word tells us that this world will be destroyed by fire the same way it was destroyed in the days of Noah by flood, and the new heaven will come to this earth. So we'll inherit the earth in heaven forever right here on this earth. And it won't be anything like this earth is now. Then it says in verse 6, blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be satisfied. I promise you, you'll never be completely satisfied this side of heaven, but one day you'll find the greatest satisfaction of all for those that are saved. Verse 7, blessed are the merciful, for they will receive mercy. When we're kneeling before our Savior and Maker, Jesus Christ, we realize how merciful He has been to us, that we don't go to hell forever. Verse 8, blessed are the pure in heart, for they'll see God. One day we'll see God face to face, not because of our own purity in our heart, but because Christ has given us His purity of heart. In verse 9, blessed are the peacemakers, for they'll be called children or sons and daughters of God in heaven one day forever. And verse 10 is an inclusio in the Greek. It starts the same way that it finishes. It says, blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness. Then you see the same thing you saw in verse 3, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. So what the Beatitudes describe are people that are saved on their way to heaven. We don't do these things to earn our salvation. God does these in and through our life because we've been saved by Almighty God. So number one, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. I am blessed because God has saved me. I'm approved by God, not because of anything I have done, but everything that Jesus Christ has done. Here's a second truth this morning. I must recognize my true condition before God. I believe we as Christians are sometimes the most prideful people in the world. We should be the opposite of that. We should be poor in spirit. The Sermon on the Plain in Luke chapter 6 just says, blessed are the poor. It doesn't say the phrase in spirit, but we know that just not poor people materialistically are the ones that are going to heaven. He's talking about what it means to be broken in our spirits, poor in our spirits. We realize we are nothing without Jesus Christ. Someone might say, I'm highly educated, but without Jesus Christ, we are spiritually ignorant. Some say, you don't know me, I'm a pretty good person. Without Jesus Christ, you are spiritually incompetent and doomed to hell. This might not be easy for you to swallow this morning, but what it means to be poor in spirit is to say, I'm nothing, I have nothing, I can do nothing apart from the grace of Jesus Christ, my Lord and Savior. I can't do anything on my own to deserve heaven. I'm nothing on my own without Jesus Christ. Nothing I can offer Him on my own strength means anything to God. In fact, Isaiah says it's like filthy rags. But the other side of that is when Christ saves me, then God lives in me, and I'm precious and valuable to God, and I'm a very important person, not because of what the world sees me as, but the way God sees me. But it starts with being poor in spirit. I believe we live in a culture today that we as Christians like to brag about what we do for God and forget we can't do anything for God on our own strength. I think the biggest turnoff for lost people is to come to church sometimes and see people boast about all they do for God, how much they give God, how much they love God, and they don't see people that are poor in spirit, that are broken before God and so thankful for all that God's done for them each and every day. Do you realize that you are nothing, you have nothing, you can do absolutely nothing apart from the grace of Jesus Christ? If you don't believe that, listen to Romans 3. I put it on your handout, verses 19 and 20. Now we know, not we hope so, we know that whatever the law says, it speaks to those who are under the law, so that every mouth may be stopped. You think you can brag about all that you do for God? God says, I'll close every mouth. Every mouth may be stopped, and the whole world will be held accountable to God. When we realize when we were lost, we stand accountable before God for every sin that we've committed, and we will spend eternity in a real hell forever paying for those sins unless we let Christ save us. So we can brag all we want to, but Christ says here in Romans 3 that every mouth will be shut up. Every mouth will be stopped. Verse 20, for by works of the law, no human being will be justified in his sight, since through the law comes the knowledge of sin. We are not justified by anything we do. We're justified by the grace of God, that Jesus Christ died in our place on that old rugged cross and took the punishment that we deserve for our sins. We're not justified by anything we do in our own merit, our own strength. If we realize that every day, we'll be poor in spirit. We'll be broken before God, realizing God owes us nothing. We owe God everything. You ever tell God you're upset with him because you don't get what you think you deserve? I am so glad God does not give me what I deserve. And I bet you are too, deep down. I'm thankful that God gives me his mercy and his grace and not his judgment in hell forever for what I deserve for my sins. Listen to Luke chapter 18. You might want to jot this verse down. It's not going to be on your handout. Luke chapter 18, verses 9 through 14, Jesus, being the master craftsman of his words, uses parables, stories. He's going to tell a parable here in Luke chapter 18. He says, he also told this parable to some who trusted in themselves that they were righteous. They trusted in themselves that they were righteous on their own and treated others with contempt. We ever act like that as spiritual, holier-than-thou people? Then it says, two men went up into the temple to pray. One a Pharisee, one a religious person. Remember Matthew 5:20, Jesus says, unless your righteousness surpasses those people, you'll go to hell. And another a tax collector, the most hated person in town. The Pharisee, standing by himself, prayed thus. You gotta love his pride here. God, I thank you that I'm not like the other men. Extortioners, unjust, adulterers, or even like this tax collector. Pretty arrogant, isn't it? Then he says this. We talk about all the works of his own flesh, his own righteousness. I fast twice a week. That's probably more than all of us, right? I give tithes of all that I get. That's probably more than most Christians do. But the tax collector, standing far off, would not even lift up his eyes to heaven, but he beat his chest, saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. Jesus says, I tell you, this man went down to his house justified, rather than the other, rather than the religious Pharisee. For everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, but the one who humbles himself will be exalted. Jesus says, blessed are the poor in spirit. Blessed are those people who do not exalt themselves, but exalt Christ in everything. They don't try to draw attention to themselves. They don't try to draw glory to themselves. I don't know about you, but I look back on my life and I'm ashamed of the times I cared about what people thought about me, and I wanted credits given to me, and it wasn't all about Jesus Christ. That's why when God led me here as your pastor, the theme that God laid on my heart for our church, our body of Christ, is that phrase, Christ-centered. Because it's not about your preacher, it's not about who leads worship, it's not about your deacons, it's not about your Sunday school teacher, it's not about getting your name on a plaque here because you gave an X amount of money, it's all about Jesus Christ. That's why we're here. I mean, I hope you don't change churches based on a pastor. I hope you come to church, not for who's preaching the word, but to exalt your Savior, Jesus Christ. As long as the word's proclaimed, I'm going to go to church and worship God. And I'm not going to let anybody come into church and the way they act keep me from coming to God's house and worshiping Him, because I'm not coming for what people think. I'm coming to exalt my Savior, Jesus Christ. And as we do that, we have to be poor in spirit because God makes us poor in spirit. We can't boast about the things that we do for God and compare ourselves to other people and think we're better than other people because we think we do more for God than other people. We can always find somebody we think we're better than. That's our problem. We don't compare ourselves to each other. We compare ourselves to God's standard. And when it comes to comparing ourselves to God's standard, do you realize how far short we all fall? Me as your pastor, chief of all sinners, I can promise you. The more I learn about God's word, the more I realize I've failed Him a lot of areas I haven't even realized yet. And it causes me to be broken before God that I don't deserve His mercy. I don't deserve His grace. But I'm so thankful He gives it to me anyway. Isaiah 57 on your handout and on the screen. Verse 15. I broke it up on the slide into two sections so we could fit it all large enough for you to all see. But listen to the first half. It says, "For thus says the one, thus saith the Lord, who's high and lifted up, who inhabits eternity. He dwells in eternity, whose name is holy." Now it's going to tell us in the second half of verse 15, two places where God lives. Don't miss this. It says, "I dwell in the high and holy place," which means He's in heaven wherever that is. We like to think it's up and hell's down, but that's just our way of describing things. He's in the high and the holy place, and also, listen to this part, He also dwells with him who is of a contrite and lowly spirit, to revive the spirit of the lowly and revive the heart of the contrite. God says He lives in two places, in heaven and in the hearts of those who are poor in spirit, which infers this: He doesn't live in the hearts of the prideful. He doesn't live in the hearts of those who boast about all they do for God like the religious people did. Hence why Matthew 5:20 in the Sermon on the Mount is so important to us, that unless our righteousness comes from Jesus Christ Himself, it's not our own righteousness, we will not enter the kingdom of heaven. We're not going to heaven because we're religious. We're not going to heaven because our name's on a Southern Baptist church roll, our Catholic roll, our Church of God roll, our Methodist roll. We're going to heaven because Jesus Christ has taken our place on the cross. We've repented of our sins. We've placed our trust in Jesus Christ. It's the only way to be saved. And if some religious Pharisees who could quote you the Old Testament scrolls were religious but lost, who are we to think we can't be religious but lost? I mean, I don't know anybody here that can quote the scrolls out of the Old Testament in Hebrew. They could. I mean, Nicodemus comes to Jesus Christ at night. He's a member of the Sanhedrin. He's a member of the elite. And Jesus looks at him and says, "Unless a man be born again, he cannot enter the kingdom of heaven." In John chapter 3, and Nicodemus says, how does somebody, he's so clueless, he says, how can somebody go back into their mother's womb and be born again? And Jesus is thinking, obviously you don't get it. It's not about a second physical birth. It's about a spiritual birth. Have you truly been born again? Has your life ever, ever displayed God's working through your life, causing you to be poor in spirit? Because Christ lives in the hearts of those who are poor in spirit, which means God has saved those and He makes them poor in spirit. Again, I am nothing. I have nothing. I can do absolutely nothing apart from the grace of Jesus Christ. Listen to what God's word says we are before Christ. Psalms 14:3. They have all turned aside. Together they have become corrupt. There is no one who does good, not even one. We like to boast about what we do. God says there's no one righteous. Romans 3:10, as it is written, none is righteous, no, not one. No one understands, no one seeks for God. All have turned aside, together they have become worthless. No one does good, not even one. We are worthless without God. We are useless without God. And some of you right now are saying, no, I've done all this on my own. I got this kind of house, this kind of job. I drive this kind of car. In God's eyes, that's all nothing. Because it does not last for eternity. That's why later in the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus says, do not store up for yourselves treasures on earth, but store up for yourselves treasures in heaven. And when I'm at my grandmother's 94th celebration of going home with Christ this past week, 94 years long life, taught Sunday school for over 50 years in a church, and I'm celebrating on Wednesday her going home with Jesus Christ, I start thinking about, you know, the more people that I love that are in heaven, the more my treasures are stored up in heaven and not on this earth. The more I look forward to going to heaven one day, mainly to see my Savior, Jesus Christ, but now all four of my grandparents are there. I know they are. I know they love Jesus Christ, and they exhibited it being poor in spirit. They didn't brag about what they did for God. They bragged about what God did for them. And the third truth, I can experience abundant life now. Not one day in heaven, but we literally can have heaven on earth because heaven's where Jesus is, and if we're saved, Jesus lives inside of us. Listen to the last part of verse 3. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is, not will be, is, present tense in the Greek, the kingdom of heaven. Some of the things in the Beatitudes are will be future. This says that we have the kingdom of heaven right now on this earth. See, the kingdom of heaven is the theme of the book of Matthew. The kingdom is here, but it's at hand, which means we can experience the kingdom of God on this earth, but not fully like it's going to be one day in heaven. But if God is your king, then you live in his kingdom right now. You don't have to wait to live in his kingdom one day. I hope you're following that. He wants to be your king right now on this earth. In this sinful world in which you live, he wants to rule your life and my life right now. If you have your Bibles, I want you to flip over to Revelation. It's not on your handout. I'm going to close with this morning. Revelation chapter 3. Talk about what it means to be poor in spirit. A little brief introduction before my voice completely leaves me. It's going to be a fun first business meeting for me with no voice. Might have done that on purpose so I can get out of the business meeting. We'll see. Just kidding. Revelation chapter 3. A little history real quick. The church at Laodicea, the city of Laodicea, in 60 to 62 AD, the whole city was destroyed by an earthquake. The Roman government sent them resources, sent them money to rebuild their city. Laodicea was so prideful, they sent the money back and said, we don't need your help. We got enough of our own resources, we'll do it ourselves. The city had a medical facility that made this salve, so when you hear this passage, you'll understand it, made this salve, and they put their trust in what the healing power of the salve had instead of the healing power of God. They also had one of the world-renowned garment-making factories there as well. So when the government said, we'll help rebuild you, they said, no, we'll do it ourselves. We have enough resources ourselves. They were prideful. They didn't appreciate the help that was given to them. Now listen in that context to Revelation 3, verse 15. Jesus says, I know your works. You're neither cold nor hot. Would that you were either cold or hot, so because you are lukewarm and neither hot nor cold, I will spit you out of my mouth. Cold water was beneficial, hot water was beneficial, but lukewarm water was useless to them. He's talking about the church at Laodicea. Then listen to this, for you say I am rich, I have prospered, and I need nothing. They're self-righteous, not realizing that you are wretched, pitiable, poor, blind, and naked. Poor in spirit, we see our true condition before God. They didn't understand that. Then he says this, I counsel you to buy from me gold refined by fire. And they're thinking, we have all the gold and materialistic things we need. We don't need your help, God. Then it says, and white garments so that you may clothe yourself and the shame of your nakedness may not be seen. And they're thinking, we got the greatest garment factory in the world. What do we need your clothes for, God? Then it says this, and salve to anoint your eyes so that you may see. And they're thinking, hey, we got the greatest salve in the world right here in Laodicea. Then he says, those whom I love, I reprove and discipline. So be zealous and repent. Now here's probably one of the most misused verses in all of God's word. This verse has been taken out of context by so many people, and they use the phrase, Jesus is standing at the door of your heart and he's knocking. And if you'll just open up the door of your heart, he'll come in and save you. And they use this verse. This verse is not supposed to be used for that. Listen to it in context. He says, behold, I stand at the door and knock. He's not knocking at an individual Christian's door. He's trying to get into the church at Laodicea, and they won't let him in. He's talking about a church, not an individual person. Then it says, if anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come into him and eat with him and he with me. The one who conquers, I will grant him to sit with me on my throne, as I also conquered and set down my Father on his throne. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. What is Jesus saying? That when you get a whole group of religious people together into a church, and no one's poor in spirit, the church is not poor in spirit. The church is prideful. The church goes around the community and brags about all they do for God. The focus gets off of God and onto the people and the materialistic wealth of the church facility, and it gets away from Christ. It's not Christ-centered. My prayer for First Baptist Church Slidell is we'll never brag about the facility here. God wants us to have a nice facility, but it's not about the facility. If we have to sit on the floor because there's so many people that come in that we just want to exalt Christ, we'll sit on the floor. It's not about what we sit on. It's not about what we wear. It's not about how much money we have. It's all about Jesus Christ. Poor in spirit. We realize if it wasn't for Christ, we wouldn't be able to worship in this facility today. If it wasn't for his goodness to us, we wouldn't have the worship chairs to sit on this morning. Because you know there's people worshiping all around the world that would never, ever fathom being able to worship in a place like this. And we come and we compare ourselves to other churches and we like to brag and we always talk about numbers. We had this many in church this Sunday and we had more than you and our choir's bigger than you and our music minister's better than your music minister, which I know is true for most places. And it becomes so much about us and very little about God. And Jesus says that's lukewarm. That's a lukewarm church. That's a useless church in the eyes of God. We'll get to the Lord's Prayer and the Sermon on the Mount. But if we're not poor in spirit, we start praying for our kingdom and not the kingdom of God. It becomes our kingdom, our church. One of my pet peeves as pastors to hear people talk about their church and their deacons. My deacons did this and my church did this. I don't have a church. It's not my church. I don't have deacons. They're not my deacons. They're God's deacons. I don't have Sunday school teachers. They're not my Sunday school teachers. They're God's Sunday school teachers. I don't have a parking place here that's my parking place. If you come on a weekday, I park in the same place because nobody else parks there. But if you want it, you can have it. Because we're supposed to be broken and poor in spirit and not trying to draw attention to ourselves, but draw attention to Almighty God. But we live in a culture today where churches are revolving around what people want, and it's becoming about us and not about God. What can we do to make the people happy? What songs do the people want to sing? What style of music do the people want to sing? What do the people want to sit in when they come? And we've let the entertainment world in which we live flow over into the church. The church is supposed to influence the world, but for the most part, the world has influenced the church, and it's become prideful people that are so upset when they don't get their way because they come to church for themselves and not for God. And when you get a pastor in the pulpit that's all about him, you better watch out. becomes a dictator style rule, and it's all about what the pastor wants, regardless of what God wants. If that ever happens in my life, please fire me the next day. Please send me on my way, because I don't want to be that kind of pastor. I hope you don't want to be that kind of believer in Jesus Christ either. That we should be poor in spirit because we are absolutely nothing apart from Jesus Christ. And some people don't like to hear that. They don't want somebody to tell them they're nothing because they think they're everything because they're gauging themselves by the way the world looks at them and not at the way God looks at us. You realize everything you have in this world, anything good in your life came from God. The clothes on your back, the food on your table, the roof over your head, the church you're meeting in today is all a gift from God. And if he were to take that away today, it wouldn't change who God is. Hurricane Katrina taught a lot of people that. That put their stock in the things of this world and forgot it should all be in Jesus Christ. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. How is the Holy Spirit talking to you today? Is the Holy Spirit convicting your heart that there's pride in your life that you need to repent of? Is the Holy Spirit telling you today that you're religious, but you've never truly been born again, truly been saved? Every time I open up God's holy word, the Holy Spirit convicts me that there's so much more in my life that I need to allow God to change each and every day. I think about the times this past week I caught myself bragging about myself and had to stop and say, God, I'm sorry. It's not about me. It's all about you. It will drive you to your knees to mourn over your sin because you're poor in spirit. These Beatitudes, I really believe they grow on one another. They're built off of one another. Poor in spirit people, they don't care what the people next to them think. If God calls them to come to the altar and get on their knees and weep over their sin, they'll weep over their sin. Are you really poor in spirit this morning? Has Christ made you poor in spirit? Let's